because, well, first of all, it sounds horrible, but because you cannot find the note when you play all the strings, the way you tune a guitar is you just play one string. Mom, that they could treat her that way. And become those who are never quite satisfied, and we never have enough, and we're discouraged. Because everything that we do never fills us up, and so we become more and more ungrateful to God. This is what it says in 1 Timothy 6:6. Paul said this, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." I'm going to come back to that word contentment in a second, so just hang on to that. "For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. There is no U-Haul behind a hearse, and if there is, that person's an idiot." Okay? By the way, you can be late for your own funeral. Somebody said you'll be late for your own funeral. I did a funeral recently, and the hearse broke down, and everybody was there, and then that person was late to their own funeral. So if you want to work it out, let me know ahead of time. I'll work it out for you if you want to be late for your own funeral. But anyway, we brought nothing into the world. Was that too bizarre of a comment for a late one? Sorry, okay, for you brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing of it, but if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. And by the looks of us, we're doing all right with both of those, right? And maybe a little too well with the food part, right? People who want to get rich. Now, this isn't talking about, see, we tend to think, well, this is talking about wealthy people. No. It doesn't say rich or poor people. There are poor people who want to get rich so bad they can't stand it. They're never happy with what they have. There are wealthy people who are never happy with what they have. By the way, we live in the wealthiest country in the world, and we still want more. People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap. That's the idea of being tripped. And many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. Now, that word contentment is a really neat word that Paul used. He stole it from a group called the Stoics. And many people think that Paul was probably friends with a guy named Seneca, or at least knew him. And there's a lot of belief that Seneca even became a Christian before he was forced to die from Nero. And that's another story for another day. Here's what he said, which I thought was very interesting. He said, "It's the superfluous things for which men sweat. The superfluous things that wear out our togas threadbare." Wear our togas threadbare. "And force us to grow old in camp," or when we're young, "that dash us upon foreign shores. That which is enough is ready in our hands." So he said, we're so busy pursuing other things that we don't even enjoy what we have. This guy's not even a Christian. And he's basically saying, I watch people, and they're running after things all the time, and they're never happy. Did you know our American society is built on having you not happy? The reason we spend money and the reason we buy new cars so often is because we watch the commercial and we never know. We never know when Star Wars is going to happen to our car. Have you seen the newest commercial? I mean, you're just going down the road and all of a sudden stormtroopers appear, and if you have this new car, it will steer you around an enemy attack from Star Wars. Gotta have it. You gotta have that car. You gotta have the car. The girl wasn't paying attention. She was watching Star Wars, and it corrected the car. Oh, I gotta have that car that drives for me, because I'm too dumb to look at the wheel and look at the road and text. By the way, I passed. I was the last one let through. I passed a head-on collision last night where the police waved me as the last one through. They closed Highway 46. So I am very aware of safety concerns with cars. However, if you're buying a new car because you don't like your cup holder, listen to this verse from Psalms 136. Now, some theologians believe that this psalm was actually written during the exile when the Jews were taken to Babylon. Others believe that it was actually just a prophecy, but either way, it's awesome. The priest would read the first part, and the people would say the second part. It says, "Give thanks to the Lord because he is good. His love continues forever. Give thanks to the God of God. His love continues forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His love continues forever. Only he can do great miracles. His love continues forever. With wisdom he made the skies. His love continues forever." Now listen, in the Hebrew, this idea of his love continues forever means his mercy is coming. If you're discouraged, get out of Psalms 136 and make your own version. Lord, you're good. Your love endures forever. Or you can say, Lord, you're good to me. Your mercy is coming. God, I know I'm dealing with this issue in my life, but you have provided for me always. Your mercy is coming. God, we're going through this trial, and you know about it, and you're with us, and your mercy is coming. You just fill in the blanks and then say, your mercy is coming. What in your life You may need to write your own version of this passage. And say, God, I'm dealing with this right now, but I know mercy is coming. Here's some ideas for you. I got this years ago from Peter Lord, but it is one of the best illustrations and one of the best tools to use. Use the alphabet to name 26 things that you're thankful for. The good news about it is even if you're ADD like me, and like you can't even pay attention to the sermon, you can sit and you can usually remember where you left off. Like you say, Lord, thank you, and I thank the Lord for apples a lot. I probably need to go with apricots or asparagus. But anyway, you start with A and B and go through, you get to xylophone, X, I don't know what you do, X-Men. And you just tell the Lord things you're thankful for, and it'll change your attitude. It'll refocus, retune your heart. And then the second thing is very simple. Ask God to make you content with what you have. We live in a society financially that's based on you and I being a little discontent. We need a little nicer house. We need a little nicer front door. We need a little nicer this. We need a little nicer car. We need a little nicer whatever. And by the way, we all have our, like I talked about cars and some of you were like, man, I never do that with cars. And then you're like, yeah, but what about? Everybody has something. Lord, I want to be content with what you give me. If you want to give me something else, that's fine. But I'm going to be content with what, as long as I have food and clothes, I'm going to be content. By the way, if you don't have food, come see us. We'll make sure you have food. And we have some really good cooks in our church, so you should have food. Number two, so not only be thankful, number two, choose priorities that God blesses. Now, I've got some really good news for you today. We are hiring for free a brand new, you like that, hiring for free? We have a brand new associate pastor coming on staff here, and you already know him. He's going to come and share. Rodney is coming. He's our associate pastor of Adult Ministries. He oversees our small groups, our adult Bible studies, our service ministries, but he's also been assisting me for a while in planning. Rodney has a Bible degree from New Orleans Seminary, and I was actually one of his professors. He had to call me Dr. Brookins for a while. Dr. Brookins? Yes. So would you welcome Rodney to the stage? He's going to share a story about this.
I've had it in my phone for 6 or 8 years now. It says Dr. Brookins, and I'll be with somebody, and I'll get a phone call. I'm like, oh, hi, I'm like this doctor friend of mine. And they'll hear things. I'm like, yeah, he always calls me to go over stuff. And they're like, anyway, I was sharing some stuff with him this week about his sermon. We were going back and forth, and I told him a story about something I did at Publix. I actually worked for Publix for a long, long time. And anybody who works for Publix, especially if you are in management, you're always going 100 miles an hour, you're always trying to accomplish things like any job out there. And if you're going from one end of the store to the other, you always pick certain aisles to go down because you know hopefully there'll be no customers on that aisle or no employees. Or you're going to the back hall from one end to the other. And I'm going to the back hall one day, and there was a stock clerk named Nelson. He was famous for stopping you and stealing time and so on and so forth. And he stopped me and was saying something, and it went on. I don't know how long, but it went on too long for me. So I gave him the, I don't know what to see. Yeah, that's a good point. And finally, I kind of turned, and he kept going, and I kind of lost it. I said, Nelson, you see how I'm standing? This is the position when the conversation's over. I'm done. Let it go. And I walked away. And felt bad, and I had to get things done. And within a week or so, a good friend of mine, who's still a good friend, and a good friend of his is here today, I just saw. But a friend of mine named John Patrick was talking to me. We're in the back hall having a good conversation. And I kind of turned and said, yeah, and he went, well, you're turning. We're done talking. And I'm like, he goes, I heard about it from Nelson. He told everybody. So then for weeks, I had to be careful. I'm like, that's, and I was like, God. Anyway, 6 months later, we're doing a DVD series for a church we do every year, and the guy was talking about ways we can change our lives and ways we can serve, and he said, maybe you want to have the ministry of interruption. Ministry of interruptions. I've never heard of such a thing. And he's like, you know, a lot of us get busy, so on and so forth. So he talked about things that we can do, and he pointed out Jesus, which is the best example we can learn how to deal with those things. He was constantly interrupted. I'm going to share three quick stories, and we'll get back with Eric. But one, when he was in the boat, which is in all the Gospels, I believe, but in chapter 4 of Mark, he's in the boat, he's sleeping, he needs rest. Of course, the boat's going crazy, and they come to him and say, don't you care that we're going to drown? Which they weren't going to drown, but of course they were scared. He could have, when he was asleep, I don't think you have to turn sideways, you just pull the pillow over your head, or you just say, leave me alone, or you say you'll be fine, but it says he stood up. I mean, he stopped what he was doing, he didn't turn sideways, he stood up, got off, from being down sleeping, and he stopped the winds, and he stopped stopped to see, and then he told him, "Do you have any faith?" He didn't turn him sideways. In chapter 10 of Mark, he's going to Jericho with all his entourage, with all his group, and somebody hollers out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And the people in the group said, "Come on, we got to go." And they told that guy to be quiet, but Jesus didn't. He didn't say, "Could somebody take care of him?" He didn't turn sideways. He said, he stood still, and he called the man to him. And it was Bartimaeus, the blind man. And he said, "What do you want?" He said, "I want to have sight." And he said, "Your faith has healed you," and he had sight. And the third one is in Luke chapter 7. He's meeting with a Pharisee. I'm sure he had plans. He had a mission he was on. "I'm going to try to change this guy's thoughts on things, or I'm going to straighten him out," one of the two. And he's in this man's house, and a woman comes in who they said had many sins. They think she was a prostitute. And she came and stood behind him. She came and stood behind him. I'm sure that was an interruption and distracting. She started crying and weeping, and her tears fell on his feet. Once again, an interruption, distraction. He said nothing. I'm sure he still kept talking to the Pharisee. She knelt down, wiped his feet with her hair. She poured oil on his feet. And then the Pharisee, it's his house. He should have stopped it. Or Jesus could have, but he didn't. And then the Pharisee said, "Why don't you stop her?" And then he gave the example of somebody owes me $50, somebody owes me $500, and I forgive them both. Who's the most thankful? And the guy said, "Well, the guy who owed you $500 would be the most thankful." And he said, "Well, she's going to be more thankful than any because she has many sins." And once again, he tells her that her sins are forgiven. But we need to have that ministry in our life, perhaps, where we see what God's priorities are. Some people think every interruption is a divine interruption. I struggle with that sometimes, but it's probably true. So we need to be careful not to turn sideways and say, "I don't know, I don't care. I got more important things," and we kind of live for him and make his priorities ours. Thank you very much.
So it's really true. We live in an American society where we're all in a hurry. We need to be, when people come to us and go to talk to us, instead of thinking about what we're going to say next, every once in a while, even you ADD friends of mine, every once in a while, try to actually listen, not just to what they're saying, but how they're feeling. I know that there's people who go on and on, and I think sometimes you do have to turn sideways and walk away. I get it. But at the same time, God has called us to say, "What is my priority for your life? What is it I want you to do?" And to take time to do that. You know, some of you grew up in homes where your parents only disciplined you when you were in the way. It had nothing to do with right or wrong. It had to do with, when you bother me, you're in the way. And so now you still feel like you bother everybody because they only did that when you bothered them, and you never learned that there's people who really care. And so let's be those hands and feet of Jesus that really care about the people around us. Now, God's given us two things. He's given us time and money. We don't talk about money a whole lot at our church, but this is Haggai chapter 1, verse 4 to 6. Great verse. It's talking about priorities. "Is it right for you to be living in fancy houses while the temple is still in ruins?" Now, let me give you the background. They had permission to rebuild the temple, and instead they built their own houses and didn't take care of the temple. And then it continues. "This is what the Lord All-Powerful says. Think about what you've done. You've planted much, but you've harvested little. You eat, but you don't become full. You drink, but you're still thirsty. You put on clothes, but you're not warm enough. You earn money, but then you lose it all because you had put a purse full of holes. You buy a big house, and you need a bigger house. You buy a new car, and you need a new car. You buy a new this, and then you need another one of those. You have this, and you want that. And you're never," I know that's not in the Bible, but "you're never satisfied." And what he's saying is, Haggai is saying to these early believers in God, if you will be obedient to what God wants you to do with your priorities, then you'll find that you're satisfied with the other things in your life. And if you're not obedient with your priorities, whether it's money or time or whatever, if you're not obedient with those priorities, then you're going to find that nothing in life satisfies you. It's never enough. It seems like you're always hungry, which I can really relate to that part of the verse. So take some time. Take some time to evaluate your resources, your time and money. See if you're giving your life to things that last, or are you just giving to yourself? If you really evaluated where you spend, the things that you do, where you spend your time, are you giving, are you investing in eternity, or are you only investing in yourself and then finding that nothing satisfies? Number two, plan your giving of time and money. One of the things I love bill pay online. I don't know if you use bill pay online. Best invention ever. Set it and forget it. So you can even give I'm here all the time. Did you know I have the bank mail my check to the church? That's how lazy I am. You know why? Because I'm busy. So I get busy. Now, at our church, I don't know what anybody gives, any of that kind of stuff. But this isn't just about money. It's about planning your life. The things that you give, the time that you spend. I would encourage you to join a serving team. Look for a way to serve other people. So many people are unhappy because they only serve themselves. Even non-Christians have figured out that when they serve other people, it brings them joy. As Christians, when we serve God, it should bring us joy. So not only do we need to learn to be thankful, boy, I really mumbled that. That was pretty good. I didn't have bacon this morning. See, it would have woken me right up. Not only do we need to learn to be thankful and have God priorities, number three, we need to find significance in serving God, not people. Proverbs 29:25 says this, being afraid of people can get you into trouble. There's that word for trip or snare again. But if you trust the Lord, you will be safe. Now, I told this story last night, and one of our ladies from Rotary was here, and I was worried that I was going to be in trouble. But I'm going to tell it anyway. It's going to be online. I'm probably going to get in trouble with someone. But years ago, when I joined Rotary, I had only been to Rotary about 3 months. And one of the members came to me and said, hey, would you be willing to serve on the board of Rotary? And I said, well, if you need me, sure, I'll serve. If that's what you need. And I thought, you know, how generous of me. You know, I'm new to this club. They don't have other people, so I'm going to step up. Well, a week later, I went to Rotary meeting, and I was on a ballot with other names. It was a runoff. I didn't want a runoff. I thought they were asking me to help. They did a runoff. Here's the big thing. You ready? I lost. They didn't want me. They did not want me. Please don't help, Eric. Now that we've asked you to serve and told you we needed you, we don't need you. Now, let me tell you the conversation I had in my head. It was not a long conversation. I really think it was a few minutes. But all the squirrels got together in my head. I have a conference room. I don't know if you have that. But I have a little conference room. All my little squirrels talk to each other. If you don't know that, I'm ADD, so little squirrels run around. They have conversations even while I'm talking to you right now. They're thinking bacon. Anyway, so the conference room, here's what they said. Oh, those people don't need you. You should just quit the club. Why are you even in Rotary? You shouldn't be in it. And by the way, Rotary's awesome for me as a pastor. It gets me in the community. I get to find out about the community. I get to serve the community in ways I haven't. It's helped us as a church to connect to various nonprofits in the community to be able to help them, places like the Boys and Girls Club just up the road. But here's the conversation I had. Well, they don't need you. They voted to not have you. I mean, they voted for that guy. He didn't even come to all the meetings. And they voted for him instead of you. You know what? Maybe stay in Rotary, but don't agree to serve. Don't offer to do anything, because those people don't appreciate you. They don't do anything. Now, I got to tell you, it was like being called to the principal's office. All of a sudden, I just heard,
Eric Brookings, please report to God. Please come in.
And here's what I heard.
Are you serving those people? Or are you serving me? Class dismissed.
Right? So I had all that argument, and then I realized, you know what? I didn't get what I wanted. They didn't make me feel the way I wanted to feel. They didn't say the things I wanted. I mean, I wanted them to beg me. Eric, you're awesome. You need to be here. No. What was God doing? Teaching me that it's not about me. See, if you're a Christian, you're going to go through frustration with people. And that's the point when you will grow or you will grow stagnant. Because when you get around people, let me tell you something about people. They are all messed up and broken. I mean, other than the pastor. Everybody else. I have thought about putting on the billboard out there, don't drive like our pastor. Just put that out there and see what people say. Colossians 3, Paul says this, in all the work you're doing, work the best you can. Work, and this word for work here is work in the spirit. It's the idea of breathing work because you're working for God. Yeah, just call me during church. That's awesome. All right. Work as if you were doing it for the Lord. Listen, not for people. Remember that you'll receive your reward from the Lord. So now he's going big picture, which he promised his people. people, you are serving the Lord Christ. Listen, for all of us, when we're working, when we're loving our kids, when we're working our family, we have to think big picture. So it means when you're driving and trying to get somewhere, you can sit and yell at the car in front of you, you can yell at the people next to you, or you can love the people in your car. You can be right in an argument and lose a relationship. We've got to begin to think big picture. God, am I being faithful to you? Gosh, serving God is not easy. It's frustrating. People reject you all the time. Early Christians were killed over and over for their faith, and we're like, those people didn't like you. We had somebody passing out bulletins years ago who somebody said, can you close the door? They literally threw the bulletins on the table and said, I will never serve here again. I'm so unappreciated. And I remember thinking, good. Why? Because we all have to go through that. Or we have that point that we say, who am I serving? Each of you has received a gift to use to serve others. Be good servants. By the way, servants don't get to ask God if they can serve. We just have to obey. Be good servants of God's various gifts, and I love this, of grace. Did you know when you help somebody and you serve them, you can give them judgment or you can give them grace? When you deal with people at work, you can deal with judgment or you can deal with grace. Everyone needs grace. Ask God to help you recognize any people-pleasing tendencies. Not in your friends, in you. Find a place to serve with a humble and grateful heart. And I promise you, as you begin to serve, there will be days that you won't want to serve, and people won't appreciate you, and things will go wrong. And that's the day that you're actually serving God, and you're not serving people. Take those moments. Our lives get overwhelming when we're ungrateful, when our priorities are selfish, and when we try to please everyone. We get back in tune when we spend time with God in prayer and in Bible study. Let's go ahead and go through this, and then I'll read the screen on top. There we go. Okay, so we need to quiet the noise by spending time with God in prayer and Bible study. God wants to bring your life into balance through three things: thankfulness, putting Him first, and looking to please Him and not others. You'll find joy and peace as you stop doing life your way and start doing God by God's way. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Christ, I'll be here after the service. We don't do an invitation where people come down the aisle during a song, but I'll be here. Like the guy last night who came to me and said, here, I just need to get my life right with God. You might be here today, and the truth is that you know God, but as I talk today, you have a relationship with Christ, but you've really not been in tune. My prayer for you is that something that was said today, you wouldn't just leave and forget. But if you say, God, would you help me in this area of my life? Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for your word and your power. I thank you that you do amazing things when we trust you. That, Father, that us broken and hurting people can be put back in tune. Lord, that you can retune the strings of our heart and of our lives, so that we have a symphony in our heart. Lord, that you can tune out all the noise and we can hear you in the middle of a bad day. Lord, I pray for that one today who's overwhelmed by life. Father, I pray that they would know right now that you're with them and you're going to bring their life back into tune as they trust you. Father, thank you that you walk with us. In Jesus' name, amen. We have a closing song in our time of giving. You give what God's put on your heart today. It's a great song, and I'll be here after church if you'd like to pray.